200,000 people every year.
We have currently nearly 250 million prescriptions.
That's my dad wearing Peter O'Toole's hat. That's Buzz Aldrin's foot. That's Ronnie Biggs. This is Peter O'Toole. This is the most famous death mask in the world. My name is Nick Reynolds. I'm an artist, I'm a musician, I play harmonica. I'm in a band called Alabama 3, best known for providing the theme tune to the show The Sopranos. And I'm a sculptor of death masks. A death mask is when you make a cast of somebody's head, and essentially what you're doing, you're using a moulding material and you're placing it on the dead person's face. The very first death mask that I did really came about purely by chance. I was doing an exhibition, 10 of England's most infamous sort of criminals, and it was basically, I wanted to highlight the paradox about how people vilified by the media on one hand can then be fated on the celebrity circuit the next. And so I said to my dad, okay, 10 of the most famous living criminals that you can think of, give me a list and I'll track them down. And so I started working my way through them. And one guy, that was my dad's mentor, who says, you must do George Tatus Chatham. By the time I managed to track him down, he just died. And so I spoke to his sister and said, can I do this, can I cast your brother? So that was the first death mask that I did. So it made me feel I was doing something worthwhile instead of just running around getting off my head, being in a band and doing art for the art's sake, if you like. Here we are at Highgate Cemetery, and the reason we're here is there's two death masks that I've done in bronze. One here, this is the death mask of Malcolm McLaren, which I did 8 years ago. It's a funny story actually how I got to do Malcolm's head. I had met him years ago when he was alive, and I'd said to him, you know, I'd drawn up a list of people whose head I wanted to cast. But this is while they was alive, obviously, and he told me to F off, actually. So years later, my kids were coming round and I was having a bit of a tidy up, and this little bit of paper fluttered down on the floor, and I recognised it as part of a collage which I'd done for a book about the train robbery. And one of the train robbers was Ronnie Biggs, ended up being the lead singer of the Sex Pistols. But as this bit of paper fell down, I wasn't quite sure what it was. I just thought, oh, that's of this collage. I wonder who it is, and how did this one piece get separated and end up in this drawer? As I turned it up and looked at it, it was Malcolm McLaren, and I thought, that's odd. And all over the papers, at the front page, Malcolm McLaren is dead. And I got a phone call, and it was like, are you available to do Malcolm McLaren's death mask? I thought, wow. And a dee-dee-dee-dee, Twilight Zone kind of thing. So that's how that came about. This is the death mask of a guy called John Joe Amador. He was executed in Texas for a crime, I believe, he didn't commit. The reason why I've put his death mask on an armadillo, the state national symbol for Texas is an armadillo. The thing that was quite striking about when I cast him was that he was still warm. And I don't know if you can see this, but when I put the cold water on his face to mould it, he came up in goosebumps. You know, his skin still reacted. The first thing I would do if they're laying there, you have to put, generally I put cling film over the hair, and with the face you would put Nivea or Vaseline, just to help as a barrier between the moulding material, and also it helps it slide off the face. Now, to actually cast their features, I use a material called alginate, This is what dentists use to take molds of your teeth. What you do with this is you add a bit of water. If you start mixing that up, it very quickly turns into a paste. And once you've got a good consistency, you've probably got about a 2 minute working time. You need to kind of push that in and get it all. It's generally pretty kind of messy when you're doing a whole head. And sometimes I've had to do the people that are actually dressed in the coffin, so it's been very difficult. The difficult bit is trying to make sure that you get all the detail. Muscles are relaxed. You know, when somebody dies, if you cast them straight away, they look like they're just sleeping.
Our death mask collection was originally in the Museum of the Edinburgh Phrenological Society, which had left with a huge collection of death masks, and so they all came to the Department of Anatomy at the University, where we've been looking after them ever since. Phrenology was a 19th century pseudoscience, and it was an attempt to understand the brain and relate it to the personality of a human being. For example, if you had an enlarged organ of benevolence, number 13 here, you would be a kind, generous person. But they would need to have some evidence for this. So as part of their evidence, they would make and collect death masks, life masks, of all sorts of different people to try and prove their theory. So the death masks in our collection were collected at the time of phrenology really being an important science. This is probably one of our most important ones. It's Napoleon Bonaparte, who died in 1821. And he would have been collected because, as one of the most famous military leaders of the 19th century, the phrenologists would be looking to see if they had any clues in his brain what made him such a good military leader. When Napoleon died, this kind of almost triggered a bit of a mania for collecting death masks. And people started to build up their own collections, so you start to see a bit of a trade developing right across Europe.
A few years back, I got an email asking would I be available to do William Rees-Mogg. Jacob apparently was so happy with it, he's asked me to do a version in marble.
Hello, Jacob.
Oh, hello, Nick. How are you? Come on in.
It'll have to be a
You've injured yourself,
left,
yes.
Right.
But come on in. Nice to see you again.
You too.
Thank you. Do come through. Nick, thank you very much for coming round. We got in touch, I suppose, just over 5 years ago when I contacted you out of the blue just after my father had died to see if you could produce a death mask. And at that point, we didn't know each other at all, and then you produced the death mask. He was also the most wonderful father and family man.
What made you decide you wanted one done of your dad?
I think it's something that was quite common in the 18th century, and my father was very much an 18th century man. He liked the 18th century. He thought it was a very civilized period, and most of his historic heroes were 18th century figures. And therefore, to do something once he died that would have fitted in with his worldview and as something that had happened to his great heroes, it seemed a fitting tribute to memorialize him in a permanent form.
The first death mask that I saw was of Oliver Cromwell, and I was totally mesmerized by the fact you could look at a person that had been dead for 300 years and, you know, this was their real true face.
Well, this is a cast of Oliver Cromwell's death mask. Cromwell died in 1658, most likely of a secondary infection, having had urinary problems. And after his death, a man called Thomas Simon came and took a cast of Cromwell's face, a wax impression. That then could be used for making sort of plaster casts, which is what this is. You can see the reverse of it there, where obviously the plaster has been poured into the original wax mould. So there are quite a few of these casts of Cromwell's face around, but all taken from that actual life, or rather death cast, after Cromwell's death. And you can see on his face here, we've got the two famous warts, as in warts and all, impressioned, one above his eye and one just below his lip there, which have been left as an impression.
So I'm just going to write, so you can just see this is set now. So if I'd covered the whole face, you can see that how you kind of, you've got all the detail and stuff like that in there. Right, so there's the eye there. And that's using alginate. You can use silicone rubber. I'm in a lonely room. This is silicone rubber. Another way, and it's pretty similar, if I'd have covered the whole head in alginate, you'd have your subject. You completely cover them, whether it be with alginate or with rubber, which you build up in layers. And then once you've got that and that has dried, you then build up in plaster and layers of plaster bandage, because this is very soft and it won't hold its shape. So you then build up on top of that, and then once that's set, you can remove the subject's face from your mould, and you have a negative. And then from that negative, there's one of two things. I could directly cast, cold cast bronze. I would end up with something like this. I spoke to him just before they executed him through lethal injection. And he said, oh yeah, you're the guy that's gonna do my death mask. And he said, man, that's an honor. I thought that's normally only reserved for people like kings. I used to think I was trash. Now I know I'm someone. Yeah, rest in peace, John Joe Amador.
So this is the life mask of William Burke. This is life mask of William Hare, two of Britain's most prolific serial killers in the 19th century. They supplied the medical schools with 16 bodies that they had murdered over a 10-month period. So life mask of William Burke, we think, was taken when he was awaiting his execution in Edinburgh. As you can see, he looks a little bit more jowly than we think he actually would have been. The plaster's kind of pushed down on his face a little bit. The interesting thing about Burke's phrenological report is it was the opposite of what the phrenologist wanted. So when they looked at his life mask and later his death mask, his organ of destructiveness was deemed to be actually be quite small, and his organ of benevolence, again up here, was actually enlarged. So that didn't fit easily with somebody who has just killed 16 people in 10 months. I think they're pretty spectacular looking. I think they're a little bit creepy sometimes, especially when you look into the eyes of a serial killer. We have a few serial killers, but I think they're actually a pretty unique historical resource.
The other mask that I got at Highgate is one I did of my father, Bruce Reynolds, credited as being the architect of the Great Train Robbery, which, for those who don't know, was a robbery in 1963. 16 men stole 2.6 million, which I believe is worth today about 50 million. Have you seen Bruce Richard Reynolds? My dad and my mother and myself was on the run for 5 years until we were living in Mexico, when my dad ran Dunhills. And we came back to do another job, and he got grassed up. There was a big reward on him, and subsequently he went to prison for 25 years, and he did 10 and a half. So there's my dad. This was white, this stone, once, and it was actually getting on my nerves a bit, the way it's discolouring from the sap of the tree. But it's actually getting quite a nice little patination now. It's starting to make it look like it's granite. It's such a beautiful cemetery, and I'm kind of hoping sort of over the years to turn this place into sort of my ultimate gallery. There's something mysterious about death, obviously, and I think during the process of taking a death mask, some of the mystery of death seems to get transferred into the actual sculpture, which always gives it that otherworldly quality, just knowing the fact that that is, you know, that's someone's final portrait.
I think death masks encourage a healthy approach to death and accepting it and seeing that it isn't frightening and that you can have a physical representation of somebody who has died as a memorial, as a reminder. But it's not my father, it's a representation of my father. And the two are different, and it's a wonderful representation, but it is not him. Something that is comforting rather than worrying.
What does your mum feel about the mask?
I did ask my mother before arranging it, and she was in favour of it, and it stays in her flat, not at my flat, so I think we can assume from that that she's pleased to have it, because she could have said, oh well, thank you, I'm glad you've done that, but why didn't you keep it at your house? So I think my mother's extremely pleased with it.
Would you consider having yourself done, Jacob?
Well, we may keep you in business for years. There are quite a lot of us. So.
Yeah, there could be.
Yes,
right.
Yes.
I better teach my children so I can carry
the thing. Generational. Yes. It's a very sort of James Bond way of finishing somebody off, isn't it?
Definitely.
Yeah, yeah.
Very nice to see you again.
Well, you too, Jacob. And
do let me know about the marble.
I will indeed. And another left-handed shake, I'm afraid. Look after yourself, and I'll be in touch.
Do be careful.
I'll do my best, Jacob.
Great, thank you.
Cheers, thank
bye.
You.
Bye.
It's a calling of sorts. It can be quite distressful sometimes, but on the other hand, it's intensely rewarding out of anything that I do. I mean, jumping on stage for an hour and a half is a great buzz, but there's something really kind of special about being able to give something so precious and personal to someone that's been recently bereaved. And I think it's important that we're in touch with our own mortality. And today people aren't, and I think death masks are a great way of grounding people and bringing them back to that, you know, anchoring and letting you realise that you're only here for a short amount of time. But I'm fighting against a whole world that doesn't want to focus on death. And I think it's to our detriment, really. I think people that have that attitude find that when it does happen to them, that they're totally ill-equipped to deal with it. I'm surprised more people don't go for them, actually. A lot of people find them quite macabre. But the way I look at them is they celebrate not a death, but they celebrate a very unique life, you know, once lived. And I think every home should have one, or two. Or three even.